Rush, one of the most idiosyncratic bands to emerge from the wave of hard rock in the early 1970s. A trio of musical polymaths who cut a fiercely independent, sometimes controversial path through various styles of music to forge a distinctive, evolving sound that was incomparable to any of the acts around them. Over a 40-year career, their concepts and experiments have pushed the accepted frontiers of hard rock, opening new territory and influencing legions of bands that followed in their wake.
They're a monster three-piece band with extraordinary musicianship, and all of them move right across from playing sort of straight grooves to very complex rhythms.
The difficult, progressive, crazy grandfather scientists of metal previous that provide all these building blocks to musicians who, you know, or kids who want to become good musicians. They're almost like the the wise elders of hard rock.
Coming from the music industry hinterlands in Canada, Rush developed firmly outside of the mainstream. Defiantly uncommercial and routinely dismissed by the music press, Rush spent the 70s on a radical journey through hard rock, progressive rock, and heavy metal to establish themselves as one of the world's biggest bands. This film traces those years and the work that carried the group from the bars of Toronto to the arenas of the United States.
It was 6 years from 74 to 1980. And they start off as a hybrid of Yes and Led Zeppelin, and they end it as one of the most cultured and sophisticated heavy rock bands with a very stylish sound that mixes, that has a pretty much perfect mix of heavy metal and progressive rock.
Rush started life in 1968 when school friends Geddy Lee and Alex Lifeson teamed up with neighborhood drummer John Rutsey to form a band in their hometown of Toronto, Canada. The trio had played both separately and together in a number of local bands and after-school jam sessions over the previous couple of years, and by the time they came together for their first gig as Rush, it was with a settled ambition to make a serious go of a career in music. For young aspirants in Toronto, however, finding any opportunities in what was a musical backwater represented a daunting task.
You have to remember that back in 1968, 1969, there really wasn't much of a Canadian music scene. Canada was more or less a branch plant, a far-flung province of the United States. We didn't have an indigenous music industry. Now, we had some bands, and we did have some places for these bands to play, but they tended to be ignored in favor of international acts from the UK, acts from the US. So it was a bit of an uphill struggle for a lot of these bands. If the ones that wanted to stay home were the ones that were starting out, other artists such as Paul Anka, Neil Young, and Joni Mitchell, and guess who? They had bailed for the United States, which is the land of plenty. But for a band that was starting up in 68, 69, it was a bit tough. You played a lot of high schools, and you played a lot of small bars for people that really didn't care.
The Toronto music scene, it was still pretty quiet at that point in 1968, 69. One of the things that it had going for it was its own little kind of Haight-Ashbury situation. It had a place called Yorkville. There was a real sort of coffee house scene, singer-songwriters. But there was quite a, you know, hippie psychedelia scene starting to pick up. Obviously, there was no such thing as progressive rock or heavy metal or anything at that point.
By 1968, rock and roll was beginning to mature. The teen hysteria that had accompanied the British invasion back in 64 had subsided, and popular music had become increasingly more experimental and significantly heavier. The Beatles and the Rolling Stones had moved through phases of drug use and established themselves as the senior bands of the counterculture. In San Francisco, the recent Summer of Love had seen the flowering of the hippie movement and the psychedelic scene. And in the realm of hard rock, a new wave of artists had started to revisit, extend, and amplify blues-based guitar. It was these acts, most notably Cream, Hendrix, and Led Zeppelin, that became the key reference points for the next generation of musicians, not least Geddy Lee and Alex Lifeson.
Cream, John Mayall and the Blues Breakers, yep. Those kind of bands, The Who.
Cream, very much so at the time.
Yardbirds. Yeah, it was that whole generation of American blues reprocessed by English rockers that I think bonded us. We both liked that kind of thing. Hey, girl, you drive me to ruin.
I don't know what it is about you that I like such a lot. Things like Free and Humble Pie and Led Zeppelin and sure, you know, they picked up on Hendrix. The Who. But, you know, the thing that makes Rush unique is that they are a progressive rock band, or even possibly the first progressive metal band. So they did start picking up on influences like, you know, Genesis and Yes and King Crimson. So, you know, they were looking to that difficult music early on. But I think a cross area or an overlap is a band like The Who and Cream. Because essentially both of those, even though The Who had four people in it, I mean, it's a power trio, essentially. Cream's a power trio. These guys were, for the most part, a power trio. So yeah, I mean, it's that early stuff where they start exploring, you start seeing jamming and difficult stuff going on. Interesting soloing, a lot of dramatic, you know, ups and downs in the music.
Rush's musical influences formed the basis of much of their early repertoire, but finding venues at which to play on the barren Toronto music scene proved difficult. The lineup of Lee, Lifeson and Rutsey started out playing a regular Friday night spot at the Coff Inn, a coffee shop housed in the basement of a local church. Though a modest gig, the Coff Inn provided Rush with an opportunity to play regularly and move beyond a set list of covers. Before long, they managed to attract something of a fan following, and had put together the beginnings of a road crew. With a drive to perform as much as possible, the band invited a young, ambitious agent, Ray Daniels, to assume management duties and expand their activity.
Ray was hanging around, I mean, he was only 16. Anyway, he kind of asked them, do you need a manager? And they said, I guess we do. Ray made the difference by having somebody out there representing you, okay? Somebody pushing, take Rush. You know, if you'll take, he had a band called Liverpool who did Beatles songs, and yes, they would do well the high school. He said, well, if you take them, I'll take Rush too. And Rush, I mean, without a bar scene for most bands, where were you playing? Like high schools, like where did they want to hear? They wanted to hear the hits. There was a circuit, but we weren't really on it because we were younger than most of the bands that were on it. They could play bars. Coffin is I went and saw it actually a couple of years ago, and in other places the band have gone and seen it. It's just a room behind a church, 60 by 40 maybe, not even that big, and you set up on the floor and the kids, it was a drop-in center so kids wouldn't do drugs, so they did drugs and came there. So that's about, you weren't allowed back in if you went out because everybody went out and partied and wanted to come back in and they wouldn't let you. I saw other bands there too, but it was a good stepping stone. It was nice to know that you could fill a room, any room.
You know, in terms of what Rush would have been playing in their earlier gigs, I guess it would have been a fair bit of covers. But, you know, Rush actually started writing originals pretty early on. Some of the various earliest footage of Rush has them playing a few originals that showed up on the first album and even on to the second album, Fly By Night. But You saw some Beatles covers, some Led Zeppelin, just kind of the big hits of the day. The Who, they were always, like I say, they were always big on The Who. But yeah, they were a band, I think, that were ambitious pretty early on that wanted to start writing originals.
The fact that we were writing music early was very, very important. With the influence of Led Zeppelin, we started to get heavier and heavier.
Yeah, we went on from there. We had Ray Daniels, and we did high schools, and like I say, beach houses, and anything. We played a bar mitzvah, which was pretty disastrous. And I know we played a bar in Oakville, and I think we played a set or two, and they said, thank you, go home.
But Rush's fledgling career was given a huge boost in 1971, when the drinking age in Ontario was lowered. The change not only opened up the bar and club circuit to the young band, it ignited Toronto's youth culture, giving Rush both a stage on which to play and an audience hungry for live rock and roll.
A couple of things happened in 71. You had all these young kids all of a sudden available to go to the bars. And secondly, you had the introduction of CanCon rules also around that same time, which fostered the creation of an infrastructure, a music industry infrastructure in Canada. CanCon rules were actually an industrial strategy, because up until that point, there really wasn't an indigenous Canadian music industry. We were a branch plant of the United States and of the UK. But with the CanCon rules, all of a sudden you had to play a certain number of Canadian artists on the radio, and that fostered the creation of recording studios, record labels, managers, producers, engineers, promoters, venues, and all kinds of things. So it was the beginning of an interesting era in the development and the evolution of Canadian music.
You know, creativity really picked up. This was the psych era going into prog and heavy metal and album-oriented FM radio. The bar scene, the drinking age being lowered, really gave a shot of energy to the music scene in Canada, for sure.
They learned their chops. Hey, you're playing the same song six nights a week. Yes, you get better at it. And we did well in that circuit. We did very, very well. If you can sell out a bar on a Tuesday night, you know, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, does the owner love you? Okay, you know, you don't walk in the bar and there's 20 people there on a Tuesday night. The place is packed and jumping. So that'll always, you know, earn you more money and get you more bookings. And we were a big band on that circuit, which kind of led you to think we could make a living doing this, you know. So it grew from that. It also got to a point where, yeah, we're big in the bars, but it's time to step up, okay?
Despite their constant gigging and growing following in Toronto, Rush failed to attract any attention from record executives. Though they had built a catalogue of original material and were diligent in sending out demos, none of the labels in either Canada or the US were willing to bite.
Well, a couple of things about Rush's early stuff is that it was markedly different from the Rush that we got after Neil Peart joined the band. They were basically a standard sort of power trio, playing the same sort of stuff that you might hear from, you know, Black Sabbath or Blue Cheer or some of those other bands, with the only difference being that you had this singer with this voice.
You know, they had some difficulty getting accepted early on. The demos were essentially rejected. It took them a long time to get going. I mean, they formed, you know, basically around 69, and the first album is a 1974 album. I think the big big stumbling block on Rush getting accepted was more or less Geddy Lee's voice early on. It's a very shrieky voice. I mean, people compare it to Robert Plant, but I never, growing up as a kid, never thought it sounded anything like Robert Plant. It was just too bizarre. So he had a very crazy high voice. It almost sounded like a novelty voice, like they'd be a novelty act like the Bee Gees or something like that.
Robert Plant, Roger Daltrey, these guys really belted it out, and they were kind of my influence. Even John Anderson from Yes had this angelic high soprano voice. I was always a soprano in school. It just seemed to be the natural thing for me, my natural range. And the music we were writing at the time was quite heavy, so for me I had to come up with a voice sound that cut through all that.
They were, bless their hearts, a very derivative band when they started. And this is not to knock them. This is just simply the case that nearly every band, when you're starting off, you're really just doing your best to emulate your heroes. You'll have your, you know, one or two like freak successes, I'm sure. But for the most part, you're just sort of establish your initial identity, and you can connect a lot of the dots. When you consider what they were, a power trio, the power trio format had been perfected to a degree by a band like Cream, The Who, Led Zeppelin, many others can be named, were essentially power trio bands with a singer as well. And you have all that together, you have essentially a really high bar already to measure up to. And Rush is, early on, is a very good case of, you know, very much doing their best. They clearly are of this sort of basic command of their instruments. They certainly have ambitions to try and do something more beyond just simply grinding out blues derivative stuff, which is what a lot of other bands were really trying to do at that time and being terribly miserable at. You could sense the reach from there. But it was a case of building up their competency, building up their talent, just not quite there yet. And again, they'd be the first ones to admit that. The magic formula had not yet happened, and of course, a certain later key membership change had yet to take place.
Rush took matters into their own hands. Their young manager, Ray Daniels, and his business partner, Vic Wilson, formed Moon Records, an independent label in which the band could put out a debut single. The move was significant in terms of Rush's entire career. Being able to record outside of the established system imbued the group with an independent spirit and the self-confidence to cut their own path within the music business.
It was somewhere between a private press of releasing one's own work and just going like, okay, let's like stake a claim and do something and all that. And you already have like the big labels out there. A certain infrastructure has already well started to take place. But there's always room for something small and ambitious to get a start with and make their way up. There could have been certainly larger ambitions to do something a little more or something a little extra beyond that. Who knows, the management may have ideas of going like, yeah, we can be our stable, we can just sort of expand it out around these guys. But it does take a certain amount of faith to just simply get that initial leap going, to sort of like, great, let's sort of put ourselves out there. And at the same time, it gives you something concrete. Even if you've been turned down by all the other labels, even if it's sort of like, man, we're not getting anywhere, well, let's put something out there so we've got something to show, hey, we can do this.
It did get an indie album out there, and that indie album is what broke them and got signed. So they were not getting signed off of live gigs or a demo, they were getting signed off of a finished album.
Self-releasing paid instant dividends. The band recorded an eponymous debut album, but unhappy with the initial production, they brought in English producer Terry Brown to fix their issues, and a new creative partnership began. The album went over well in Canada, achieving radio play and quickly shipping its initial run upon release in early 1974. It was also picked up by a radio station across the border in Cleveland, and Rush consequently caught the attention of American industry figures. The band were finally offered a contract, an initial two-album deal with Mercury Records that crucially gave them complete artistic freedom.
Rush, the album, is a terrific record. Some very strong songs on there. I mean, I love Finding My Way, the opener. It's a great way to open. I must admit, the first time I ever heard it, I was with some mates, and we were like, well, you know, who the hell is this dude singing? It's, you know, Geddy's voice is quite a squawk on the first album. They're finding their feet, they're young, they're energetic, it's full of youthful vibrancy, and yet it's still got enough musical capability to let you know that, hang on, there is something a bit special about this band, and it's not difficult when you look back to see that, yeah, this is a band, for example, that could make 2112, whereas if you took any kind of like blues-based hard rock band to put an album out in 74, sort of maybe sort of stunting by their third or fourth album because it's just the same stuff over and over again, which of course is something Rush never ever did.
They just want to be a great rock and roll band like their heroes, and the lyrics just sort of serve the songs. They're a barroom rock and roll band. They're just singing about rock and roll themes, just general, you know, working man, get up and party, and that type stuff. So it's pretty regular pedestrian stuff at that point. But you know, no one really calls out the lyrics as anything terrible either, because the music is so good. It just all goes together, and it's just a good rollicking hard rock album for 1974.
It is an okay record. I mean, it is a chunky power trio record with riff-heavy songs like In the Mood, which became a Canadian radio hit, and it's fine. There's nothing really wrong with it for its era. It just didn't give us much of an indication about where this band was going to go, even a year later.
Though the Rush album was a largely unremarkable, if solid, debut, there was one song in particular that had attracted the major record labels. The album's final track, Working Man, a lengthy, unusual hard rock number, had been singled out by US radio and had prompted Mercury Records to approach the band.
It's a song that I think captured the imagination because it really was about just rock and roll dudes and talking about actually working men who weren't rock and roll dudes, but maybe the audience who's listening to FM stations in their early days, and that's why it did break out of Cleveland. You know, Rush is a Cleveland, Detroit kind of band at this point.